tonight, we have something special. We have one of our own, Deek Diedricksen, author of Humble Homes and Microshelters, which is his new book. He'll have copies to sign and sell hereafter. You may have caught him briefly on HGTV at a show called Tiny House Builders. And he's also a man, he's a painter, an author, a musician, teacher, and what he calls a micro-architect, right?
Sure.
Here's our own Deek Diedricksen.
Thank you. By the way, just some of you are probably wondering why there are a lot of Cub Scouts here. I'm a Cub Scout den leader, too, so you can add that to the list, I suppose. So I saw some bears here. I think there's a couple of tiger cubs as well. So thank you guys for coming out. First thing I always make sure I do before I do the talk is I'm like, oh, thank God I didn't wear that shirt. Because a couple times I've given talks and I stand up here, I'm like, oh, son of a, I'm the guy, you know, I wore the same exact shirt as the lead photo in the slideshow. But I'm psyched to be here. I've spoken many places. I just got back from a book tour. For like Josh said, Microshelter is my new book. And I was on the West Coast for almost 2 weeks in Vermont, New York City, did a bunch of dates. I've been all over the place. So it only makes sense to do an actual speaking event here in Stoughton. The slideshow I'm going to show you, I'll never see that book again. He's a shifty one. So Alex, you can be my demo guy. As I talk about the book, you can flip the pages and hold it up, all right? You'll be like the Cub Scout male version of Vanna White. So there's a reference none of them get. So where are all my books going? So this book, like I said, my most recent one, it's a far cry from Humble Homes, Simple Shacks. Quick story before I get into the slides on this one. This book I never ever intended to publish through an actual publisher. It was done out of my basement. It's kind of like a, you know, I grew up as a total comic book nerd playing in punk rock bands and reading zines. So it's all like hand done. Just a crazy amount of sketches with all this stuff shoehorned into it. I didn't want to go through a publisher because I had tried before with a children's book and failed miserably. So I just pressed it out of my basement using copy inks, Lisa Wheeler and crew down there, using a mom and pop copy shop in town to produce them all to support a Stoughton business. And I hand bound all of them in my basement with a comb binding machine, if you remember those things. All right, guys. with a comb binding machine that I bought at a yard sale for $10. And if you remember, those are the ones we have to keep pulling the lever over and over to punch holes. So we used to have binding parties in my basement once the book started selling well. And it was only a matter of time before my kids lost interest. You could only bribe them with candy so long to keep binding books. But that book, by word of mouth and a lot of blog stories and, you know, internet, newspapers and such, sold about 3,500 copies out of my basement. That I had to package, go to the post office, ship off. So at one point in time, I joke, I had the Pee Wee Herman-esque arm, which I still have, and the other was Schwarzenegger-esque from that binding machine over and over. And then it led to this book more recently. This book took me about 3 years to put together, mainly because most of the stuff in this book, foolishly, the things that I built, designed, sketches I did, and I showcase the work of others, some friends in the scene, the whole tiny house and micro shelter, if you want to call that building scene, to support them. But a good portion of the stuff in here is stuff I photographed and built and staged, you know, did the decor, design, all that. So it's kind of the long, slow way to get not rich. So the lead photo here, growing up as a kid, I was, you know, I'm a total ADD case. I would always go in the woods and with like freebie wood given to me by construction workers with permission. Because most of them are more than willing to give it to you because they have to pay, you know, to get rid of stuff by weight in a dumpster. So I take the scrap wood and build tree houses galore, cabins, forts, all back on private property that wasn't mine in the swamps in Connecticut. And the reason we build in the swamps is because, I shouldn't give the kids ideas here. The reason we built way in the swamps is because if we're building on someone else's land, no adult in the right mind is going to come back through this swamp, crossing these treacherous, slippery logs, you know, fighting off mosquitoes to come in and yell at us kids that are building and making that racket in the backyard an acre or two back. So that was the reason. So I've kind of gone from that to more recently, as Josh said, we did a kind of a mini series for HGTV, some stuff for the DIY network. I've worked for HGTV kind of three times with different projects. And this was the, and Devin was pointing out, one of the scouts, are these a bunch of your redneck friends, I think he said? And yes, pretty much. This is a crew of builders I put together. The idea behind the show, it was supposed to be the antithesis of a lot of the design shows where it's nothing but like gleaming tooth supermodels remodeling your house? Because I don't know the last time you've hired someone to come and work in your house. I don't get any, you know, supermodels or Fabio fixing my plumbing. So we had a crew of people I put together that I worked through over the years. We had the my New Hampshire buddy who had worked on with some HGTV stuff, online stuff in the past, and he was my kind of ghost carpenter, they call it. So if I was doing decking and had to narrate and build, they're not going to have me do 50 boards in a row. I would do about 7 of them, then start prepping the next thing just to conserve energy, you know, because I had to host and be active the whole time. He'd be my ghost carpenter. So you see these close-ups where all of a sudden my hands get about 20 years older for these close-up shots, and all of a sudden I have a different ring in my hand, and my hand gets a lot hairier, where he's doing the close-up work and a couple decking things. My buddy Shippy looks like a pirate. This is me. They said try to look mean. That's about as mean as I can look. I look more like, you know, Pee-wee Herman on a bad day. Johnny Milwaukee, simply because he's from Milwaukee. He was the oddball, not from this area, so we called him Johnny Milwaukee. My friend who simply goes by Creature, slash an extra from the Sons of Anarchy TV show, he looks like. And this is my brother Dustin with a fresh mosquito bite in his forehead, because for the show it was pretty insane. They gave us a week, put us out in the woods, ill-equipped, off-grid. You know, let's see what we can build in a week by way of cabins, tiny houses, or tree houses. And it was pretty brutal, especially with the bugs. So this is kind of the lead shot in the TV show that was called Tiny House Builders. So from building in the swamps illegally as a kid to doing a show and wasting lots of HGTV's money, which was kind of fun. And I'll get to that later when I show some of the builds, because there were some things I never would have put in a build myself, but since they were cutting the checks, I'm like, let's try this. What about a diamond-studded trim around the windows? No. I added a couple slides. I do this I do a slideshow, and I added a few for the Stoughton talk, simply because the Cub Scouts are in the room, and more recently, to kind of jump around and tie this in, we built, with the help of a lot of parents in the room, too, and donors, we built this little cabin that's now on display with the Scouts at the Fuller Craft Museum in Brockton. This is the entrance to the Craft Museum, this big horn-looking, you know, deck or walkway they have to the museum. So if you go outside of the museum for free, you can go walk up to this thing, peek into it. There's some funky artwork in there and all. You can see some owl toys and tigers and crazy stuff in there. Pretty whimsical, weird, and way out. It's something that we built collectively with the Cub Scouts as a fun fundraiser. It took a lot longer than I thought because I got so busy with other projects. It was supposed to be done kind of last year. But it's done and now kind of up for silent auction in a sense, where all the money from that will go to helping out the Cub Scout pack for activities, camping, and all that stuff, because it does add up. So it's 7x7, about 10 feet tall. Believe it or not, there's a little ladder way in there. You can kind of see the shade of it or shadow of it. There's a mini like bunk loft in there, which is just long enough for me to lay down in. That's usually how I build things that are really small. As long as I can lay down in there, I won't even use a tape measure, we're good to go. It's like the hillbilly approach. 6'4", I used to be, I don't know, you know, just osteoporosis. I slouch, so. Here's a shot of it at night. Not really a great shot, but we put a timer on it, too. So although the museum's only open till 5 now, it gets dark at, what, like 2 p.m. these days? So if you head out there at, like, 4 o'clock, a light turns on, and the thing has this nice, cool glow. It's almost like this, I call it, like, it has the look of an Asian lantern with all the little purlins and cross pieces we built in here from a lot of scrap wood we had received. So definitely go check it out, and if you have deep pockets, go buy it and help the kids out, will you? This is inside, very vibrant, you know, in color, like I said, whimsical before. And that's kind of how I style a lot of these cabins. I'm a kid who kind of never grew up, you know, for a living. I finished a treehouse in Bridgewater, Mass, earlier. I don't have photos of that one in the slideshow. I'm not that efficient. But this is a lot of donated wood. That was from, someone tore down something, I forget, and had all this tongue and groove wood here. This was a bunk bed ladder we found on the side of the road. We just painted it. So a lot of this stuff is found, free, or donated as a way to keep the cost down. But not only that, I was trying to teach the kids that you can take stuff that others see as junk or that's being tossed away and entering the waste stream. You can recycle it, put it to use, or in some cases, later in the slideshow, you'll see I can make it into art or different funky furniture pieces and sell it, you know, for money to thereby buy the things I can't find. Some call it trash picking, or you're a dumpster diver, and, you know, to some, those are bad words. To me, it's just all awesome. Pretty much everything in here just about is made out of scraps or leftover, you know. I'm sure most of you recognize that IKEA pillow, seeing as IKEA is here in town. Getting to some wilder cabins. The story behind this is a couple years ago, I was just building this stuff in my backyard just as a way to have fun, I don't know, stay out of trouble, and just, you know, I just want some places to hang out, read, and make these little passive solar cabins in the backyard. This one was called the Gypsy Junker because from the outside it loosely resembled an old gypsy Vardo, you know, a gypsy wagon. And this was built as an experiment. I said to myself, can I go around the greater Stoughton area and just casually, not even really looking for it, find pretty much all the materials I need to build something out of street-side junk? Can it be done? So everything in here was found with the exception of the roofing, which is Tuftex polycarbonate. I can't find that stuff. And there was a set of wheels under the cabin so that it was portable. When I say portable, it took me and my brother, who was like 300 pounds, you know, linebacker size, to slowly wheel the thing around. I wouldn't want to run a marathon with it. But it was a simple little office cabin where this little bed was designed to be the same height for usage as a desk so I could work in there. And, you know, I actually worked on some of the parts of my original book in this cabin. You know, when in Rome, why not write some of the book about funky cabins from a funky cabin made out of junk in my backyard? And I just a lot of things I tried out. This is all Lego together freebie mill wood that they chuck. Windows on the side of the road. These are boards from the Brockton line. There's a truck place that sells truck caps. And they had these long boards and these forklift pallets, and they were throwing them out. And I said, can I have those? And that's the walls, board and batten style. Board and batten's where you take planks and cover each seam with a batten strip. This was actually, there was a heater in this, too, that was Gilligan's Island or MacGyver style, made out of, like, a frying pan, cement, a vegetable can, dryer vent, this and that. And it ran off, like, a multiple-wick hurricane lamp configuration that ran off waste vegetable oil. And it actually worked. And it was in the original incarnation of the book, but later when published, I took it out because I didn't want to encourage kids to play with fire and hot oil. So the publisher didn't take it out of the reprint of the book. When I later got a real publisher, I took it out. I didn't want kids coming up to me looking like Freddy Krueger, and that wouldn't be great. There's some morbid imagery. So yeah, this was the Gypsy Junker. This cabin, not this shop, but years back, that was the kind of the start of when things got a little bit crazy. I had a guy call me from NPR who wanted to ghost me or follow me for the day to do a story on all the weird stuff I was building in my backyard. Because I had, there's been times I've had like seven crazy little structures and wheels in my backyard. The guy from NPR came out and did a story. Then later on, I get this call, this woman, my name's Joyce Wadler from the New York Times. I'm like, yeah, whatever. It's my brother doing a woman's voice and trying to mess with me. I was about to hang up, and it turns out it really was a woman from the New York Times who came out for a full day, flew out, and just followed me while I built, while I, you know, not went to the bathroom, just about everything, writing a story about it. And that led to some crazy offers and future gigs and tree houses and some pretty wild, interesting stuff down the road. And it's been a unique experience since. So this goes back a little bit further. I have, as a kid, I was endlessly building tree houses and forts. And ever since I was about 16, I used to work in radio, worked for WBCN in Boston for 7 years as a DJ, weekdays, 7 to midnight. And for the longest time, I wanted to save my money to buy some land. I just wanted my own piece of land. So I was saving up money, living cheaply. And when I was 22, I bought 10 and a half acres of land, dirt cheap in Vermont, which is totally off-grid, no electricity, no water, no women for that reason. I try to convince a lot of my friends back then, come on up, you know, what, no electricity? So anyway, it's definitely roughing it up there. And this is a cabin we started building from recycled materials again. A lot of discarded stuff or kind of second or third grade stuff from mills that they were selling dirt cheap or as kindling in some cases, which is criminal, seeing as it's Vermont sustainably grown white cedar. And it's just something that morphed. A lot of people ask me, you know, because there's videos of this online, you know, Deek, is there a plan set for this cabin? Honestly, once upon a time when I was talking to my brother at Wendy's, I sketched out something in a napkin that I then wiped my mouth with and threw away. That's the extent of my planning on this one. It's from the low point in the hill to the peak is 27 feet tall, but about 10 by 10. So it's like this spire. We call it the redneck skyscraper in the woods. Almost everything in here was carried down a trail. You can't drive to it. We wanted to keep it out of the way and hidden. All the cement for all the footings and all the cement work, keep in mind no running water, we had to haul it in from rivers. So it was all really done the hard, long way. And we learned so many lessons doing that. You know, lots of things we did wrong, which is great because that's, you know, learning the hard way, but I'll never forget some of the mistakes we made. But in terms of space efficiency, because it's very important for small spaces, just a couple, nothing profound here, but this is a Murphy bed behind me with all the calico different shades of recycled wood. Murphy bed's a bed that folds down from the wall. The dart board does have a bungee cord in there, so when you lower it, the darts don't fall into your face. That would be not so fun late at night. This is another one of those IKEA Norbo or something like that tables that just flips up, very handy. The step here you'll see in the next picture was the perfect height, so we left this one elongated so that we wouldn't have to bring in another seat for the table when it's in its raised mode. It's the exact height of a seat, not that I need to act that out. This is not a ladder, because ladders are a little dangerous to ascend and descend. So this at a slight cant or angle is kind of a galley style, like in boats, staircase that worked out nicely. We simply left the opening between the joist spaces there, which is some odd denomination, like 20 inches, which isn't the way to do things. But each year, as we start to put on a little more weight, we realize, like, oh, we're kind of letting go, because it's getting tougher and tougher to fit through that little squeeze spot there. So it's kind of the reminder that we need to run some laps when we go up there each summer. What else? I mean, the coffee table, there's storage in there, things like that, and built-in shelves galore behind the stairs. So there's a lot of built-in stuff when it comes to small spaces, tiny houses, tree houses, and the stuff we design. This is another shot. You can see the seat coming out before it was trimmed out. Recycled roofing is a heat shield because we had this Nordic stove, a Swedish boat stove in there that's gravity fed for heat. Later we added onto the cabin, now we have a wood stove. It's way up in northern Vermont, and it gets really, I mean, they've already had plenty of snow up there. It gets cold. The cabin has yet to be insulated, and people are like, you're gonna freeze to death in there. We've gone up there many times in December, January, and once you get, it's not efficient, but once you get that wood stove roaring, I mean, it's like, you know, if you had a vinyl collection in there, it would be a Salvador Dali painting after a while. Melted candle wax vinyl. You can see this stairway goes up to a loft up there. And in the next picture, which shows how unconventional and Mickey Mouse-esque haphazard this build is, it's this big spire. It was all built with recycled materials because I had no money. So it's all plywood siding, which is certainly not the way you do it. Bob Vila is not going to come out and be like, Deek, thumbs up. Let's feature this in an episode of This Old House. At some point in time, I want to put some cedar shingles on it, you know, put the Tyvek and all that. But for the time being, because we get enough sun exposure here, these, when wet and the sun comes out, these vertical surfaces dry pretty readily. And what we do to prolong their life, this cabin's been there now for close to 15 years, we'll go in the woods, cut a couple birch saplings down, duct tape a paint roller to it, and get some waterproofer and just walk around or get on a ladder and just re-waterproof the whole structure once every 2 years, let's say. The windows here are, it's a seasonal cabin. They're all storm windows. I think when all said and done, there's an addition in the back that goes a ways out now. It's like 300-something square feet now. 17 windows, every single one of them found side of the road or being dumpstered at renovations, where I simply, it's the power of asking. I would go by if the people happen to be out, had windows leaning up, they're being replaced. Excuse me, sir, ma'am, you getting rid of those windows? 9 times out of 10, they'd be thrilled to get rid of them. They're not like, you're a trash picker, because they're psyched that they're getting new life. Beyond that, these people would invite me, oh, you're looking for this and that? Come into my garage. It'd be like the holy grail of junk in there. So it's the power of asking. What's the worst that's gonna happen? People might say no. So 17 windows all found, you know, for free. This is something we built more recently. So a lot of the structures when I do workshops, I start dabbling. And I use that word today a lot, dabbling. I never use that word. We start messing with whimsical structures that are just these simple seasonal structures. The woman came to me, this was in Waltham. She said, I want something built where I can drink wine and read books, and that's it. She said, I want a lot of natural light. So we only had 2 days to build it in a very, very limited budget. So I use this Tuftex roofing, as I do often now, as a wall instead of roofing. And, you know, the R value, insulated value, is not going to be great, but again, seasonal cabin. And gave it this whole clear look. So at night, the light radiates through it, illuminating these kind of angled, bizarre supports that this Tuftex is actually affixed to. And during the day, you have all this beautiful sunlight coming in. And this space is really small. It was only like 6 by 8 feet because we had some salvage materials and a limited budget again, but it's very tiny. And but by having this giant, expansive wall of natural light, it makes it feel quite a bit bigger. It tricks the mind into thinking. If you have a lofty ceiling or a lot of natural light, it tricks your mind into thinking the space is a little bit bigger than it is. We skipped one. That door you'll see later in the back. We didn't have money for a door, so we found one behind a factory being thrown away. The center recessed area was kind of punched through. You know, some teenager played Hulk Smash through it. I don't know. We took a bunch of pallet wood, and you can kind of see it here, and inset it to correct that and make it look a little more funky and unique. It's my daughter, Angie, by the way. It's not some random girl just sitting next to me. So she wanted to be on stage. Later, she's going to take over most of the slideshow. So this is just something I added later. This is, again, that clear stuff, which needs a good wipe down there. We built a mini treehouse in Vermont. Oh, I should add, my land in Vermont now, where we do workshops, I have 10 different cabins. So I'm a little bit addicted to building weird, bizarre structures. So we have a couple treehouses, 2 treehouses, and 8 different cabins, all radiating from a central campground and fire pit. It started where Memorial Day weekend, we'd have my brother's birthday up there in the woods, and all my friends would come up and hang out, but these lazy bums would never bring tents. So they'd all cram into the one cabin we had, you know, fresh after a pigging out in burritos, and you know what that leads to. So finally I said, that's it, I'm building my own, you know, building separate cabins where I can stick my lazy friends. So now we have like 10 of them. But this is with all scrap wood and left over. We hadn't Legoed together, you know, or pieced together the floor with scraps. It's just this kind of clear shell way up in a tree in the middle of the woods. It's so camouflaged, you don't really see the thing until you're within 10 feet of it. It's like in this tightly grown grove of pine trees. This was one we did for HGTV. The thrift tip here is, again, well, aside from, you know, space, visually space saving too, is we built this whole array of windows here. This, from this point to here, was close to, I think it was 18 feet or close to 20 feet. We went to a restore or a New England salvage and demo. You ever seen that place? I've been there, New Bedford. It's massive, 80,000 square feet. And they had a bunch of windows that were kind of just letting go, the cheapo pile. And I think all those windows, including new wood, this window was a little more, but this entire wall here we did for like a little over $200. And it's a huge wall because we had a budget again, or so they told us in the beginning. Later, after we tried to save them nickels and dimes left and right and killed ourselves doing so, they're like, we need a flat screen TV, a wine fridge, a bathroom, a electric fireplace. And they made us put all those things into this seasonal cabin in the woods. This cabin here is partially, not really, a tree house. There's 2 shag bark hickories here that it's affixed to. There was a stream, so as you arrive, there's stairs here. This is a bridge that crosses a stream that takes it 2 other leveled decks that takes it to the entrance. As you walk in the cabin, there's a glass floor, so you can see the stream that flows under the cabin. There's a solar light, so at night the stream's illuminated, so as you, you know, walk or you're hanging out, you see the stream running under you. It was all done very cheaply. I think the whole cabin we built for like $8,000, including all the bells, whistles, and weird toys. Heat-wise, yeah, it'd leak like a sieve, but you know, it's a 3-season cabin for this family. Clear roofing and all. The idea was to really kind of link the indoor living with the outdoors. So in the next slides, you'll kind of see that. Aside from saving money. Okay, this is just how tall it is inside, which makes it feel a little bit bigger. It was, I think, 10 by 12 feet or 12 by 12, but also had this fully standable sleep loft with a queen size bed, mosquito netting, all that other stuff, just for decor. A lot of tiny houses, you'll see slides later of that too. The lofts where you sleep are, it's kind of like sleeping in a coffin, they're so tiny. So with this, we're like, I'm sick of ducking all the time and playing Quasimodo. I want a big, tall loft for people to be able to stand fully in there. This right here, we had this an antique milk crate contraption on pulleys. You could light candles and winch it down, light it and pull it back up. You know, we had a lot of candlelight in there as well to make it all romantic. A secret door behind this bizarre last-minute decision. We just took a bunch of sticks and leftover paint and made this mock art piece that was a little bit off the floor, so you don't think it's a door because it doesn't descend all the way to the floor, but it opens up and there's a bathroom behind it. There's a wine fridge somewhere. I'm looking for it. I don't know. There's like a cook surface. There was a wine fridge in here somewhere. I don't know where the heck it went. But you'll just have to trust me on that. Not important. So here's that wall of windows. We framed out that whole front wall with 2x6s just to give it more rigidity and strength, but also because the lips of each one of those windows became a little shelf for cool bottles. So when you have the lights inside at night, when you're looking from the outside, that light passes through all those cobalt blue bottles, those colored glass, and it's just this really funky, hippied out look in the middle of the woods. That's why we picked all these different, at different flea markets, all these different, you know, colored glass bottles, the milk and magnesia bottles. I think this one's just Arizona iced tea right there. And yeah, unfortunately, I don't have a slide of the glass floor. That's kind of foolish. But it's like probably right where I was standing and taking this picture, beneath me is the glass floor, which was like a Lexan substance, almost 2 inches thick. this little piece of glass, or I don't know, a couple feet by a couple feet, was like $600 just for that one piece. So that was one of the aforementioned things I normally wouldn't buy and splurge on, but it worked kind of nicely. Another simple cabin we built for the show. And with this one, the quick story is the woman had a horse paddock right over this way towards my daughter. She wanted a space. Yeah, we built these things with a kind of wish list they gave us. And in the end, we tried to meet all those wishes and then gave it to them for nothing. They didn't pay a dime for any of these. Sounds nice. So this right here, she wanted kind of a little 180 view where she could sit in a hanging chair and watch her horses, drink coffee, read a book. We couldn't afford, when we looked at Anderson windows or any windows, these big windows. So what we did is we went on Craigslist, thank you, Craig, and bought a set of sliders, dismantled the frame, and just statically mounted the slider doors as two windows. The whole slider set was $50. Instead of paying like several hundred dollars per window. You know, the doors, things like that. You'll notice the doors opening outward. That's simply to save space. That swing space inward in a house that's only 120 square feet gobbles up a lot of room. And then some people argue when a wind blows against the outside surface of your building, that serves to help better seal your structure by, you know, pressing that door closed. We had a gag in the TV show, which failed miserably, where, you know, a lot of TV shows are contrived and they fake a lot of stuff. We didn't, except for one thing, and I was against even faking this. We had a scene where they were putting in that window, and the guy, Phil from New Hampshire, he was supposed to mess up, slip, and drop the window and shatter. It's going to be the whole scene where I was mad at him and all that. We did the scene three times, and the window wouldn't break. So it just kept falling. So we're like, forget it. So, you know. So I finally left a cut where the window just doesn't break, and we're all laughing. We put it back in, and it was, you know, true laughter. It wasn't like the Full House laugh track or anything like that. But a lot of, you know, even just the corrugated metal here, just very quick to put up and inexpensive, because we had 4.5 days, if that, to build this. Because halfway through day five, if we weren't done at a certain time when they had to go in and do the decor, which we had to help with too, they needed enough time to shoot it with daylight, because if they go over in a shooting day, it's like another $20,000 for the production company with all the crew they have. So literally, when you get to a certain point, you're not done painting, they're like, get out now, get out, like physically removing you, even if you haven't finished, which is tough to get used to. This is inside, save some money by taking a bunch of, when I build, I hate having to haul stuff away. It's part laziness, it's really foolish actually. I'll save all the scraps and find some prolonged way to use them and infuse them in the build so I don't have to cart the stuff away. So we had all this pallet wood from some of the deliveries and just from whatever else. And we chopped it up, watered down some paint, stained it to make it look rustic. And then with a nail gun, I just assembled this, you know, again, Lego together pallet wall, which behind it has the vapor barrier in that. This cabin was insulated, has a bathroom, had a shower, sleep loft, all that. And they, you know, they put a TV and all these things I normally wouldn't put in there. But it was, while tiny, it was fully outfitted for living. That one's in Plimpton, Mass. Just something simple. This year's kind of been a whirlwind for me and my brother. We did a lot of home and garden shows. We do these live builds. I call it watch the freaks behind the ropes. The 20 by 20 space, they'll give us these materials. Let's see what Dustin and his brother, Dick and Dustin, can build, you know, in 2 days with this pile of junk. And it's a lot of fun. It's challenging. So we did a lot of these home and garden shows, but this past year we got a call fully paid for and then some to go out to Sydney, Australia to do a build. I was like, what? Again, thinking it's my brother messing with me. So we went out there and built a prototype, super affordable shelter with a loft. There's a bathroom behind that graffiti door, believe it or not. That's going to be part of a 5-unit compound as a shelter for battered women. So they're going to build these safe houses where people can go. And they finally moved this one just the other day to this beautiful farm area where women in abusive relationships can go as a safe haven. So it was pretty awesome that that's what that was going to. So I designed and we built this with a crew of about 20 people in 2 days. And it's, you know, been worked on since. These are my kids hamming up, modeling for a shot that's in the book. This is in Newton, Mass, a tree house. The woman said, I want a tree house where I can see what my kids are up to from my kitchen window when I'm doing dishes or cooking. So I said, oh, I'll make the whole front wall clear. You know, you'll cook your kids alive when it's sunny out. No. It was under a tree. So a lot of people see the video like, their kids are going to get hurt in there. It's going to be too hot. It was under a tree, an oak tree. So in the summer, you have the shade of the tree. In the winter, when the leaves drop, you want that passive solar gain. You want heat in there, that free heat. So it's a simple, small structure. I convinced her to make it a little bit taller than she wanted originally. and to add in a flip-down desk. So when the kids get tired of it or as they get older, she can use it as a mini office up in her tree in her backyard. And there's a flip-down desk right about here, you know, window that kicks open. It's a very small treehouse, but with the purlins and structures in the front, I decided why not make it kind of look like a, here's a nose, two eyes, and the shrugging eyebrows. Why not make it look like a giant robot head? And I kind of field out or you know, screen through my clients when people call and try to find people who know what I do video-wise, so they'll just let me have free reign. This is the one time where the woman saw me starting to erect this structure and like, oh God, what are you doing? That's kind of weird. My neighbor's going to complain. She ended up loving it. I said, just let me, you know, finish it. If you don't like it, I'll change up. She loved it, and her neighbors loved it as well. So thank God. But it's kind of this robot face complete with two solar lamps in the eyes that charge by the day, and at night, you don't see it here, but there's irises that light up. So I joke, it's like this scary voodoo temple in the woods. But, you know, slash an office that was built for like $800 or something really cheap. Materials and all that. This was posted in the New York Times article. The woman wanted something very triangular. Not finished in this photo, but it's a tree house. For the record, it is not attached to this tree. The rule of thumb, that's actually about a foot or so away. The rule of thumb is I try not to use trees that are less than about 12 inches in diameter. And there's a certain way you have to affix your supports to the trees, too, because trees are an organic swaying entity. And you really have to work with them and account for that movement, or they're going to tear your tree house apart. So building tree houses is a little bit tricky. This one's only at its high point, like 7 feet off the ground. But this woman who was a New York City prosecutor called me up and after the New York Times article and threw a bunch of money at this project and said, just build me something in the woods where I can sit, read books, drink coffee, and when my niece and nephew come up, they can stay in there. So this one was wired for electricity, but not very efficient in its shape. And anytime you build triangles are strong, you know, if you look at truss systems, they're very strong and used in building prevalently, especially in collar ties. But when you get to triangular shaped structures and even A-frames, there's a lot of pinch space and head bumping areas. So it looked funky, and at night it kind of looked like a UFO in the woods, but not very space efficient. Speaking of A-frames, this was in Boston for a show we did called Kids Play Spaces, Kid Spaces. They changed the name like 5 times, so I honestly can't recall. And simple A-frame, but again, tough text, diffuse light, white stuff to allow light in, but to maintain privacy. Chalkboard wall, removable table, kind of a little kids art studio. And on the back side of this wall, there was a climbing wall as well, where the kids could climb the whole A-frame to get to the top, you know, ring a bell. And then the ridge beam here, you know, the challenge or the goal was to make it multifunctional. The ridge beam extended towards you guys, and where the structure wasn't enclosed, that ridge beam became the support for a swing set and a little deck and picnic area for the kids. So it was like a tea party, picnic, you know, rock climbing, art studio, funky A-frame, I don't know. They didn't like one of the things, there was 3 other things they could pick from. St. Louis, another one, this is where they gave us a pile of stuff, build something. And when we finished, it was auctioned off for a charity. The reason we use all these crazy angled purlins is because I like the look of it. It's reminiscent of like a lot of 1970s chapels and churches. But also, when we get piles of wood, there's always these short little stubby pieces. Like, how do you make use of this? And how do we use it so we don't have to cart it away later on? So we'll just cut the different angles, line it up, and create this array here. And we make sure we leave some horizontally or install them horizontally so they can serve as shelves here and there as well. And when you build tree houses, this isn't one, but it could be a tree house. When you build like that, those are just 2x2s, it's very lightweight because you have to build and hoist this stuff up in a tree. You don't want to overburden that tree as well. This is inside, you know, very, very sparse and simple because I can't fly with decor to St. Louis. This is actually in Stoughton. There's a horror author in Stoughton, Massachusetts. I don't know if he wants me to say his name, so I won't. But he wanted a space to kind of hang out in and write. It's a kind of the least sinister and macabre writing studio I've ever seen. But to double as a greenhouse as well. And the quick story here, a nod to Craig from Craigslist, if there really is even a Craig. These windows are Anderson windows. They were a little bit over 6 feet tall and 36 inches wide. If you guys have done building, I don't know if there's any tradesmen or contractors in here. Anderson window that's about, you know, 6 feet and change, they're pretty pricey. And depending on the level or grade of them, some of them are easily over $1,000. My brother found 7 of them on Craigslist for $400. So the whole front was 4 of them here, to bring it out to 12 feet. I used one in my Vermont cabin, and the two remaining ones I sold for more than $400. So we got them all, in essence, for free and saved a bunch of money in the process as well. There's a floating floor in here that can be removed because, in greenhouse mode, this is thermal mass right here. It's all dark stone, so as the heat comes in, it sucks up the heat and is more slow to release it at night. And later they put in what's called a trome wall. You can put in big barrels that attract heat. Water will hold the heat for a prolonged period, and slowly that heat radiates through the night, keeping the temperatures a little bit higher in there once the sun goes down, for growing plants. We saw that one already. Here's that door. These are all out of order. Pallet wood before we used a router to kind of make it look pretty. Some paint that I think we actually found as well, and a door that was kicked through but that we fixed up. This is in my yard for the scouts who've been over to my house. It's in varying states of disarray. I call my backyard the Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome Oompa Loompa Village. So there's always some weird structures. We built this. It comes apart in 4x8 sections. We built it for a show years ago where we had to prefab it, take it apart, put it in a truck, drive it down to Brooklyn, assemble it live on camera for a time lapse for the show called The United States of America on the History Channel. And then once they said that's a wrap, we had to take it apart, put it in a truck, and drive it back home. I knew darn well when they were done, being Brooklyn, where space is at a premium, they'd have no use for it, so they let us keep it. I brought it home. It sat in a pile. I was going to sell it. And I'm like, I just put it together. It's like a play storage bunk house. There's a bunk bed in there for my kids in my yard. We got bicycles and stuff in there right now. This is it at night, more of that Tuftex. My neighbor, Paul Acivita, very good man, very open-minded. He has let me, when I started doing workshops, I bought insurance to do it properly. I'm having 50 people over who are using tools. I better do this the right way. So I found out I was able to be insured to do these workshops, but not if I did them in my own yard, which I'd done a couple times way back. So the loophole was, I'll rent my neighbor's triple lot, which is, 10 steps over, and do workshops there. So at different times, his yard has had some bizarre structures, which he's cool with. I said, Paul, if you have guests, let them hang out in there and whatever. This was a art studio that was really tiny, kind of like a Rubik's Cube. I was up in Maine vacationing, and those windows that are 3x3, they're just sashes. They were at a town dump. My father-in-law is with him. I said, Paul, stop. I must have those windows. He thought I was nuts. I used them for the front array of this little cabin that later was in some home and garden shows. And the rest of the windows I sold for like $40 a pop on Craigslist to get the materials I couldn't find. Here's down at the Rhode Island Home and Garden Show. They called me up. Hey, we saw your cabin on YouTube. Can we pay you a sizable amount of money to borrow it? I said, yeah, keep it. So here's the phrase you're going to hear over and over here is found it in the side of the road. So this is inside. This is one phase of that little cabin, which is only 7x7 feet. So this little day bed here is sitting atop, partially supported by kitchen cabinets found on the side of the road. Sounds gross, but these cushions, outdoor grade cushions from a recliner, side of the road, but I went to a local laundromat where the person who ran it didn't look too thrilled, kicked them into a machine and washed them a bunch. Side of the road. Scraps left over from other builds, most of which were found on the side of the road. Shingle found the side of the road made into art, shelf side of the road, window side of the road, chair, yard sale, $4. A bunch of pier style girders I cut up to put plants on, side of the road, crate side of the road, lantern side of the road, and you get the picture. All the stuff I just found, put into a cabin for decor, and a lot of these I build for fun. By word of mouth, they later sell. I've sold every cabin I've ever built, just having fun building one, then someone comes along, I'll offer you X amount for it. Sure, get it out of my yard. This is later at a different show where we kind of punk rocked it out from like Pac-Man. My son built a little Pac-Man Lego ghost there. And all the crazy art here, there's a Lego figure. All this art is done on scraps that are just left over from cuts and builds. Some stuff, a lot of the paints were from HGTV. When we finish the shoots, they're not going to fly that stuff back to LA. They're going to throw it all out. So me and my salvaging friends, like flies on, we were taking all that stuff. What else in there? I have an affinity I talk about in the book with decor when it comes to cheap stuff. I always use pillows because they offer a lot of color. They're comfortable. They're art that's usable. I love glassware, glass bottles. You get them cheap or find them. Lanterns and light because it's, old-fashioned lanterns are light and, in a sense, they're art. They add something decor-wise to a structure. We called it in the, we used the phrase with the HGTV shoots and other Shoots, we did the PLB, Pillows, Lanterns, Books. Hit it with the PLB, which we could do for like 50 bucks and make a place look a lot funkier. North Carolina, all found windows, just a little shed studio someone wanted that we were messing with the group. Not done here, but that was the general idea. They were tearing down a house across the street that part of it had been fire damaged. I went over and simply asked, can we take some of this wood? They thought it was nuts, but they let me have anything I wanted. So we built an extra deck and a couple other things. We built this kind of chevron pattern door with a bunch of scraps as well. We started doing, and I'm going to wrap this up if you guys have questions too, and I know there's some younger kids here who are going to like, oh my God, let me get out of here. I want more cider. So we started doing a lot of, you know, I'm a total ADD case, so my interest and aim changes a lot. We started more recently, in the last year or so, doing builds and kind of going into the shelter as art realm, where a lot of art galleries want some weird installations. This is one we did in Putnam, Connecticut, in an art gallery. The whole thing comes apart in pieces, and each year they're going to reassemble it. So the plan is reassemble it and use it in different configurations. On the river is a houseboat, in a tree somehow. And this was the thing we built there that was in an art studio, shelter as art, and designed to bring people in to kind of give that studio some PR or some, not notoriety, that's not the term I want, but just to attract people to get them some new business. Furthermore, all the back flat walls of that gave them some new wall space to hang art as well in a somewhat small gallery. These kids you might recognize from the crowd here. This one is hidden down there. Jonas, you want to talk about this? No? No? Every once in a while I do the slideshow, he'll come up and talk about it. So I do a lot of YouTube tour videos. You know, I got a channel, I got like 250 videos. He's done a few of them before, little tour videos. But this is actually in the book because I want to show some of the high-end stuff that I've built, but also friends of mine have built, like tiny houses that cost like 60,000 bucks. I build stuff a lot cheaper than that or a lot simpler. But I also want to show a couple examples of more of the kid built, you know, ramshackle, freeform, funky, uninhibited builds, because even those have something to glean. Yeah, something you can glean from them. There's not a photo here, but my son took a bunch of different shaped boards from one of the sides. I'm like, I love the look at that. And that kind of re-inspired me to do some of the multicolored walls in my builds. Oh, there it is right there. Devin, hold it up for everybody, will you? Jonas's treehouse. Yeah. I think I say something, Jonas pretty much has that chapter memorized. In the end, I say, you know, I put it in the book also because my kids down the road can say, see, Dad did let us do cool stuff, you know, later when I'm not so cool in their eyes. So this is another tiny house. This is actually a little thing on wheels that I'm rehabbing. A friend of mine in Royalston, Massachusetts, got divorced and built a 6 by 10 foot tiny house with a loft, and he lived in it for 18 months so that he could save money. Until he could build a slightly larger tiny house that's 250 square feet. It's 250 square feet off-grid and fully legal, his home now in Royalston, Massachusetts. So tiny house scene-wise, people are making a lot of gains and working with the building department and finding ways to, you know, to coexist with codes, to do it right. You know, a lot of people, I'm a fan of renegade building, but there's a lot of people out there who want to just fight the power and forget all building codes. A lot of those make a lot of good sense when it comes to egress, to be able to get out of a structure when it's on fire. You know, you want firemen to be able to get into your structure. There's a lot of things that were put in place for a reason. This is tiny, 6 by 10 feet with a loft. You know, you can't see it here, there's like a little built-in desk here, there's a window over here, I'm going to put it back in. There's what's called a wet bath. A lot of the tiny house terminology is ripped off from the nautical world. A wet bath is pretty much a stall that's completely waterproof, so that it has the toilet in it, but it's also a shower. So it saves space. I've been in ones. I've stayed in a lot of Airbnb.com rentals, tiny houses, houseboats. Some of them are as small as like 2.5 by 2.5 feet. You're just in like a, you know, Doctor Who phone booth showering, you know, vertical coffin. That has one of those. And the loft is very, this is like the world's skinniest ladder. I don't know what he was thinking. I got to rebuild a way to get up there. I didn't even need a little tiny house, but he was selling it, and the price was so good, I'm like, I'll take it. And my wife's like, oh, God. My wife over here, super trooper, she's awesome. Very tolerant woman. This is the little loft. So for those of you who are claustrophobic, this is what I'm talking about before. When I built that treehouse for HGTV, I'm like, I want space. I don't want to, like, crawl around like Gollum to go to sleep. These are my kids up in the tiny loft that pretty much sleeps one that's above that space you saw before. He had, you can see the flue, he had a wood stove in there. That's the first thing I took out. It took up too much space. It was this tiny little marine stove, but visually it ate up too much space and didn't work. More tough decks, just where you can bring in some natural light and the, you know, everyday ordinary objects become a little more interesting, just the pots hanging there and the silhouettes and the shadows they cast. This is the friend. So my book tour, I was gone for like 8-9 nights. Every single night when I traveled, I stayed in a different Airbnb.com listing. Each one was a tiny house, which I shot a full tour on, some of which will be coming up on my channel. This is one I stayed in. It was outside Portland, Oregon. And it's just a cool little cozy cottage. And her loft up there is a little less crypt-like, simply because she has that big old skylight there, which lets in all that natural light. The structure I have is a little window in the end. If there was a fire, maybe if I Criscoed myself up and got a running start, I could squeeze through there and be safe. I don't know. But this, that's one of the merits of having a skylight, and I recommend that to people. If you're building a tiny loft, at least put a skylight in there. Method of egress, you know, whether it opens or not, you know, you can have some ventilation. That's going to be the hottest spot in your house. And you have all that natural light. And when it rains, you can sit there and you have the comfort of knowing I'm in my cute little shelter with the rain beating right near my face. There's a certain satisfaction in being able to lay right there and watch the rain cascading down glass so close to you. So she rents this out, like many people do now in tree houses, through Airbnb.com. And she gets huge money for it because it's in this beautiful expanse of land on some, not the Puget Sound, some body of water out there that's amazing. So I walk down to the, you know, the waterfront, you see like whales in the distance. I mean, the land must have been worth like $2 million. Tiny A-frame we messed with the side opens up to expand the space, mosquito nets drop down. Another A-frame, and a lot of A-frames. I just like the 1970s or, you know, before the A-frames. Again, the chapel look, this is simply a shelter way out in the woods of my property where people can bring sleeping bags and crash. This is like the Alice in Wonderland, Timothy Leary setup. That was the Providence Home and Garden Show. Another structure I built, complete with giant fiberglass mushrooms. Shameless plug for my other book. Yeah, I got some books up here if anyone's interested. Just talk to me afterwards. And I'm going to just show you a couple more slides and I'll wrap things up. So I take a lot of the scraps, if I'm not working them into a build, I make funky, weird tables out of them, cutting 45-degree angles. These tables can sell, depending on the grade of them, the hairpin legs I did not find, but they can sell for a decent amount of cash. And I can take that money and then infuse it to my videos or into the materials I can't find, as I mentioned. I put in here as a joke. This was a structure I built a ways back, and the idea was you can take, my son is a pickle addict. Very high sodium levels. So we have all these pickle jars. This is a Vlasic gallon jar. I said to myself, like with forts or sheds, you could take a jar, put it against the wall, 3/4-inch plywood wall, trace it, jigsaw it out, slip it through the wall, give it a little bit of support, and it becomes not only a window, but almost something that's storage or like could be used as a terrarium. So you're looking through a terrarium in the wall or storage, and you have all this natural light coming in, and it costs nothing. So I've done that a couple times. This is just a side view at one point in time, you know, in the dead of winter. Again, R value, terrible. But just something fun you could potentially do in your, you know, your shed. This is me, thumbs up. You know, I get quite a few of these washing machine front-loading windows from the Stoughton Recycling Center. I love that 70s look of windows with tree houses, but, you know, if you look up portholes, you know, I want a Lusitania original porthole off eBay, and any porthole for that matter, they're pretty expensive. So I started using these. It's thick glass, and it started with my Frigidaire front-loading washer that died. So I cannibalized the thing and used different parts and made into all this stuff because it was just, you know, it couldn't be repaired. So the glass is thick, and it already has this nice, I won't call it ornate, but it's nice thick trim around it. So I don't have to cut out any plywood or wood trim. This is my daughter at the Cape Cod EcoFest when I temporarily tack one up as a display. This was a tiny prototype for a homeless shelter. That was, oh God, it was like 14 square feet. And at one point in time, there was like 8 kids in it somehow until one of them farted. There were no kids in it afterwards. So it was, just some other funky stuff. Instead of the old log stools, you know, put a little mushroom pedestal seat on it, make it fun. Not done in this picture, but this was in a tree house. I call it the voyeuristic birdhouse. We talk about that in the book too. There was an armchair next to this, It's in a treehouse, and the bird feeder isn't hanging yet, but it hung just beneath this. And the idea is, as birds come to feed, they're always looking left and right and all around for predators. They rarely look straight up, especially when they're under a surface. So you could sit in an armchair. When the feeder was there, they'd come and perch and feed. You could just sit there like 2 feet away and watch the birds feeding, which is pretty cool. I mean, how often do you get that close to cardinals or blue jays? This is depression glass. I usually bring this one around. It was a quarter at a yard sale and probably worth far more than that. But I take things like this from yard sales or dollar store, you know, fake blue glass candy dishes, and I insert them into interior doors. And the overall effect in the end run is that of a much higher priced door, believe it or not. So you can take something like this. Say you had a bathroom door. You wanted to inset that. It's still private. You get diffused light in, radiant light coming out when the lights are on, so you know that, you know, little Johnny's in there doing number two or whatever. And it just looks kind of neat once it's trimmed out. So a quarter and some cheap trim can make a door look a little more fabulous with not much work put into it. This one wasn't done and trimmed out, but it's a general idea. I was in the process of working on one here. It's a dollar store plate. Leftover pieces of wood from a barn and some other projects. At first, I just needed color and a build for staging it. Wall hanging them later, I'm like, oh, I'll make it to a table with a titanium crate that was being chucked and pipe fittings for legs. You know, the stubs, the flanges, the pipe fittings. Super strong. You could, you know, dance the Macarena on top of that. It'd be fine. Neighbors might talk, though. I'll leave you a couple of goofy ones. We did a shoot for Yahoo.com, a video shoot, and this they wanted one of my tiny houses. I had a deck. They wanted it staged, you know, for the summertime. Some chairs, some tables, this and that. I didn't have a table, so I heat my house with wood. I went to the wood pile like minutes before they came and found this stump and quickly painted it to make it into this little goofy table, which worked well until the woman almost sat on it, who was the host, and she was wearing like black pants. She was like, no! Still wet. Side of the road, we needed a table for another TV shoot we did for a trailer or a pilot. And this was a table where the legs were kind of busted. So I said, oh, let's take a drumstick that I had to measure each, and we'll just cut off the broken legs and make it into a short squat coffee table instead of letting that be thrown away. And I'll leave you guys with this one. Not exciting, but any of you guys know what this is? What? Not you, Jonas. Any idea?
Vacuum?
Oh, yeah. Matt Gabriel, our resident pyromaniac. So it's like a mortar shell for launching commercial grade Roman candles, fireworks. When we go camping in Vermont, my cousin's a total pyromaniac. So he'll spend like $1,000 on 2 fireworks, launch them off, and just leave everything, you know, all the trash behind. So I'm cursing his name and shaking my fist. Then I realize all these things he's leaving behind. I'm like, wow, the plastic's really thick in those. What a shame that they would chuck something like that. So I took a bunch of them. You just pilot some holes in them, paint them some funky, you know, robin's egg blue. And like you saw on that coffee table, they're really sturdy coffee table legs. They're not high end, but if you build a coffee table with that chevron pattern work that's made out of junk that you found from different barns, different tree houses, the leftovers, then you can pile it with some firework legs. It makes for a pretty interesting conversational piece, in your living room. Where'd you get that coffee table? They expect me to say Target or, you know, Kmart. Oh no, they're in for a long story. So I joke to people, don't dare come over to my house and ask where that came from, because there's about 80 things in the house that have a long story behind it. That was a part of an old gypsy wagon from a circus. And, you know, that's about it. Oh, okay, this is the last one. I lied. I take a lot of the scraps as well. Nothing gets thrown out. We call it the hot dog theory. Nothing goes to waste. Kind of gross, but my brother and I always called it that. So I started taking the scraps, and once in a while I do these procrastination art projects. I sit in the back area when I should be working on something else. I'd sit there with a nail gun listening to loud music and just start firing away, making these geometric patterns, these little art pieces, these shadow pieces. And this is one I made. I call it functional art. I jokingly call it, you know, functional art fart. This is a bunch of scraps left over, but it's functional in that I joke, I can walk in the, it was gonna hang by my door, and I ended up selling it, but it's gonna hang by my door. I could walk in, hang my keys in this hook, entertain myself, because I'm a very simple man, by spinning this propeller. There's a cast iron bottle opener here, if you want a cold one. For some reason, a dinosaur, and I jokingly say that signifies, you know, I guess I can feel glad that I'm not yet extinct. I just nail gunned a dinosaur toy to it, I don't know. tribute to my grandfather. It's some old ham radio dial or something in his radio studio he had. And behind number two with rare earth magnets is a secret compartment where you could, you know, hide money or whatever else. So it's functional art and just juvenile, kiddish art that I posted a picture on Facebook and some guy's like, I'll give you $300 for that. Sold! So, so I've been to a lot of those since. You know, doors, here's another coffee table. I don't know if it's because someone in town might own this one, I'm not sure. And a bunch of others. The scraps, I made this for a friend in trade who gave it to his uncle, sent me a picture, and this weird drumming art piece in a scrap of wood, he sends me the pictures hanging up on this wall with all these gold and platinum records. I'm like, who's your uncle? It's like, oh, he's the keyboardist for Billy Idol. I'm like, interesting, yeah. So there's a couple interesting builds I've done or might be doing. The drummer from ELO, Electric Light Orchestra, follows my blog and wants me to build him a drum studio near Philly. I'm like, I'm a drummer. I'm like, that would be awesome. You know, like a near Hall of Fame band. So yeah, that's pretty much it in terms of a lot of the stuff that's kind of off the top of my weird ADD mind and worked into these books here.
Before we get to the questions and books, while I have all your attention, I just wanted to give a pitch for SOLA, which is sponsored tonight's program. Support our library organization, formed a few years ago as a nonprofit to help support programs and activities at the library so we can really bring you even more than the things we have been bringing you, special programs like this.